Next, I would like to welcome Lindsay Hastings. There's been a small typo in the program. The name of her presentation is Generative Leadership and the Ripple Effect, Investing in the Next Generation of Leaders. Nebraska Human Resources Institute, which is a leadership development organization here at the university. I have the pleasure of working with wonderful students like Field and Caitlin and Matt, so I consider it a true honor to be here in front of you today. But today's talk is all about generative leadership and the ripple effect, investing in the next generation of leaders. We're going to challenge what we know about leadership, and we will consider how this next generation of young adult leaders, like I see before me, will tackle the challenges they will inevitably face. But before we talk about this notion of generative leadership, let's provide a little background, a little context. Let's go back about 60, 65 years ago, to the mid-1940s. During this time, the field of psychology was primarily interested in studying what's wrong with people. Okay, identifying people who were mentally ill, and then figuring out what's wrong, diagnosing psychoses, neuroses, various forms of disturbed or deviant behavior. Well, Dr. William Hall and Dr. Donald Clifton, who were two education psychology professors right here at the university, these two guys were much more interested in studying what's right with people rather than what's wrong. These two guys were much more interested in identifying people who were extremely successful and then figuring out what talents contributed to their success. When Dr. Hall came here to the university, Don Clifton was his graduate student. And the two of them began to identify students in their classes who demonstrated what they called high human relations capital. Basically, they identified students who were extremely successful at influencing other people. So they gathered these students and began studying them. And what they learned from their research was that all of these students pointed to a person whom Hall and Clifton termed a difference maker. Okay, so when asked, like, why do you think you're an influence on other people? These people talked about how, well, you know, so-and-so had a profound impact on me. I feel like I want to do the same for someone else, and so on and so forth, creating a ripple effect, if you will. Well, this idea of having and being a difference maker really inspired Hall and Clifton. And they thought, you know, here we have all these students who have this high human relations capital. What would happen if we deliberately gave them an opportunity to be that difference maker in the life of somebody else? And that's what gave birth to Nebraska Human Resources Institute. Well, I can tell you 60-some-odd years later, we're doing the same work today. We identify and select outstanding college student leaders. We give them an opportunity to be a difference maker for a K-12 student leader. So even though we're doing the same work 60-some-odd years later, I see a new challenge facing this generation of difference makers, and a looming question of how they will create a ripple effect for generations to come. My friends at Nebraska Community Foundation tell me that Nebraska is going to experience its largest intergenerational transfer of wealth over the next 50 years. 51 Nebraska counties in particular will experience their peak years for wealth transfer just in the next decade. This trend is not unique to Nebraska. Okay, the largest generation in this country, the baby boomers, they're turning 65 and entering the red zone for retirement. These individuals are currently holding the vast majority of leadership positions, okay, in business and industry, not-for-profit sector, and in our communities. So in my view, this is not just a transfer of wealth issue, this is a transfer of leadership issue. So my question becomes, how will this generation of young adult leaders embrace this transfer and create their own ripple effect? How will this generation of young adult leaders that I see before me seek to contribute to this transfer of leadership rather than just consume this transfer of wealth? First, let's consider how we might define leadership. What words might we associate with the term leadership? Some of us may be thinking about a person who holds a leadership position. Some of us may be thinking about a person who motivates peak performance in others. These are all right answers. In fact, the term leadership does not have a definition upon which leadership scholars can agree. Doesn't that blow your mind? Leadership scholars can't agree upon a definition of leadership, but the common denominator among all definitions of leadership is the notion of influence. That leaders in some way, shape, or form have a profound influence on the thoughts, feelings, and behaviors of others. So I think we can extend our original question to say not only, okay, how might this generation of young adult leaders contribute to this transfer of leadership, but rather, how might this generation of young adult leaders contribute to this transfer of leadership and be effective at influencing generations to come of difference makers? I think the answer to this question comes within the intersection between generativity and leadership. Okay, now let's get honest. Most of us are thinking generativity sounds like a made-up word. And you know, a few years ago I would have agreed with you, but it is, in fact, a real word. It's defined by the concern in establishing and guiding the next generation. Generativity has been found to be the highest predictor of social responsibility. So what that means is that the more generative a person is, the more likely he or she is to contribute time and money towards building a strong family, a strong community, and a strong workplace. But generativity is considered to peak during one's midlife years. This makes sense, okay? Generativity is commonly expressed through things like parenting, coaching, mentoring, leadership, service to others. And middle-aged individuals are heavily engaged in things like parenting and coaching, so this makes sense. But if we know that individuals peak in generativity during midlife, what we then also know is that young adults, you know, among scholars as well as the general public, young adults are not considered to be highly generative. So the question becomes, okay, if young adults are not considered highly generative, well then how do they become more socially responsible? Mere aging? You know, do we need to wait for this generation of young adult leaders to become middle-aged before we can expect them to be socially responsible? Can we afford to wait decades for them to become more generative, recognizing that they will inherit the bulk of today's leadership positions? You know, tomorrow's leadership demands that we find answers to understand how to cultivate generativity in young adults. And this was the foundation underneath my research. I saw that, you know, middle-aged individuals are not the only ones heavily engaged in activities such as mentoring, leadership, and service to others. You know, in my job, I see young adults engaging in those activities every day. So I wanted to look at college student leaders who mentor, and I wanted to compare their generativity levels to two different groups. The college student leaders who are not, college student leaders who are not mentoring, as well as compare them to general college students. I utilized standard generativity measures for three different indicators of generativity. One being generative concern. This refers to the extent to which a person wishes to contribute to the next generation. Generative action, which refers to actual tangible behaviors that promote the next generation. And generative commitment, which refers to decision-making and goal-setting that takes responsibility for the next generation. Here's what I found. First, when I compared college student leaders who mentor to general college students, what I found was that college student leaders who mentor demonstrated significantly higher generativity in all areas of generative concern, generative action, and generative commitment. Then I looked at college student leaders as a group, those who mentor and those who do not, and I compared them to general college students. And what I found was that college student leaders as a group tended to demonstrate higher generativity in two areas, generative concern as it relates to making a contribution to community betterment, as well as doing things that will have an enduring legacy, along with generative action. Here's what was even more interesting. When I compared the two leader groups, when I compared college student leaders who mentor against college student leaders who do not mentor, I found that college student leaders who mentor demonstrated significantly higher generativity in two areas, one being generative concern as